Guys, welcome to all of you on our channel, that is Achieve IAS. So friends, as you know that on our channel we are targeting the exam of civil services, and for that purpose we have started multiple series on our channel that target your prelims as well as mains. So in this video we will be talking about our current affair MCQ series, in which what we do, we daily discuss your MCQs from current affair perspective. So today is 20 October, so let's see what are the questions of today. So the first question is, consider the following statements. First, the Chief Justice of India and the judges of Supreme Court are appointed by the President under Clause 2 of Article 124 of the Constitution. Second is, according to the convention, the government has never rejected names recommended by incumbent Chief Justice to appoint his successor. So we have to choose that which of the above statements are correct. Let me tell you friends that the first, only one statement is correct, A, that is one only. So Chief Justice of India Ranjan Gogoi has recommended Justice Sharad Arvind Bobde as his successor, and the 47th Chief Justice of India in keeping with convention and seniority norm. So how it works, basically it is Chief Justice of India is traditionally appointed by the outgoing Chief Justice of India on the day of his or her retirement. By convention, the outgoing Chief Justice of India selects the most senior then sitting Supreme Court judge. So seniority at the apex court is determined not by age but by the date a judge was appointed to the Supreme Court, and two judges are elevated to the Supreme Court on the same day. If two judges are elevated to the Supreme Court on the same day, then one who was sworn in first as a judge would trump another. So if both were sworn in as judges on the same day, the one with more years of high court service would win in seniority stakes. So an appointment from the bench would trump in seniority an appointee from the bar. So then is it a part of constitution? No, the procedure has not been laid down. Simply Article 124 says that there shall be a Supreme Court of India with Chief Justice of India and other judges. So Article 26 is basically the closest mention is in Article 126, which deals with the appointment of an acting CJI. Though thus the procedure is not there in the constitution, and the procedure relies on custom and convention. So this is more about detail, so you can pause the video and can check the detail. So mostly the procedure is initiated by law minister, who seeks the recommendation of the outgoing CJI at the appropriate time when he is near the date of retirement of the incumbent CJI. So the CJI sends his recommendation to the law ministry, and in case of any doubt, any cons, then CJI can consult the collegium regarding the fitness of a Supreme Court judge to be elevated to the post. So after receiving the recommendation of the CJI, the law minister forwards the same recommendation to the Prime Minister, who then advises the President on the same. So President administers the oath of office to the new CJI. So government, does the government get a say? So in case of appointment of the CJI, the government has no say in the appointment of CJI. So vis-a-vis the appointment of CJI and appointment of Supreme Court judges, the key difference is that in case of former, that is Chief Justice of India, the governments cannot send the recommendation of the CJI or the collegium back to them for reconsideration, while in later the government can do so. So if however the collegium reiterates those names for appointment, then the government cannot object any further. So more detail you can check in Indian Polity, and the sources of the question is basically the Hindu. Now let's move on to the next question. Next is, Sir Akbar Hadri agreement seen in news is related to A, Naga insurgency, B, states reorganization, C, border agreement, D, none of the above. So friends, answer is A, solution is A, so Naga insurgency. So June 1947, Assam Governor Sir Akbar Hadri signed a 9-point agreement with the moderates T. Shakri and Aliba MT, which was almost immediately rejected by FISO. So if you are aware about the post-independent Indian history, then you may be aware of the name FISO, who was extremist leader of Naga insurgency, who wanted a sovereign status and separate nation for the Naga people. So more details you can check, and now let's move on to the next question. Next is, consider the following statements. First, Guru Ravidas was a contemporary of Bhakti Saint poet Kabir. Second, Ravidas devotional songs were included only in six scriptures, Guru Granth Sahib. So we have to choose that which of the above statements are correct. Let me tell you, friend, that only one statement is correct, and that is first. So yes, Guru Ravidas was a contemporary of Bhakti Sen poet Kabir. So he is believed to be a disciple of Ramananda, and Mirabai is believed to be the disciple of Guru Ravidas. So he was basically born in Varanasi to a caste so called untouchable. So leather tanner's caste. So he was a famous poet and saint of the Bhakti movement. So he was contemporary of Bhakti Saint poet Kabir. So one of his famous disciples was the Saint Mirabai. So his compositions have been included in Guru Granth Sahib. Apart from that, Panchvani text of the Dadupanthi tradition also has within Hinduism. Hinduism also includes some numerous poems of Ravidas. So it is not just songs and poems are limited to Guru Granth Sahib. Panchvani text includes various poems of Ravidas. And then Ravidas taught removal of social divisions of caste and gender and promoted unity in pursuit of personal spiritual freedoms. So among the Ravidas moral and intellectual achievements were the conception of Begumpura, a city that knows no sorrow, and a society where caste and class have ceased to matter. Now let's move on to the next question. Next is consider the following statements. First, Financial Action Task Force is an organ of United Nations. Second, Financial Action Task Force has put stable coin, which is a cryptocurrency, under its observation for being used in terror financing and money laundering. So friends, let me tell you that first statement is wrong. Basically, Financial Action Task Force is a body based in Paris. It is an independent organization that that oversees the financial integrity of the global of entire financial infrastructure. So it takes steps to prevent money laundering as well as terror financing. So yes, it has kept a stable coin, a cryptocurrency, for observation for being used in terror financing. So it sets standards and promote effective implementation of legal, regulatory and operational measures for combating money laundering, terrorist financing and other related threats to the integrity of international financial system. So if a country is put on grey list, then it means the country has failed to curb terrorism financing and money laundering. So if the country is placed on the blacklist, then that means all the doors to international finance will be kind of shut for that country. So now Pakistan is in grey list. So this body was founded in 1989 to combat money laundering, terror financing and other related threats to the integrity of international financial system. Now let's move to the next question. Next is consider the following statements. First, Human Rights Council members are elected by UN General Assembly for a period of 3 years. Second, the council carries out the universal periodic review of all UN member states, which allows civil society groups to bring accusations of human rights violations in member states to the attention of UN. So which of the above statements are correct? We have to choose that. Let me tell you, friends, both of these statements are correct. This human rights council members are basically elected by UN General Assembly for a period of 3 years, and it carries universal periodic review of all UN member states so far as human rights in these member states is concerned. Human rights in these states are concerned. So about UNHRC, basically it is made up of 47 member states, which are selected by UN General Assembly, that is UNGA, on a staggered basis each year for 3 year long terms. So members meet around 3 times a year to debate human rights issues and pass non-binding resolutions and recommendations by majority vote. So members serve for a period of 3 years and are not eligible for immediate re-election after serving 2 consecutive terms. So council also carries out the universal periodic review of all UN member states, which allow civil society groups to bring accusations of human rights violations in member states to the attention of the United Nations. Now let's move to the next statement. Next is aflatoxin found in food is produced by A. bacteria, B. virus, C. fungi, D. none of the above. So friends, the answer is C. fungi. So aflatoxin is found in basically various types of agricultural crops, for example corn, peanuts, cottonseed and tree nuts. So main fungi that produces aflatoxins is Aspergillus flavus and Aspergillus parasiticus. so which are abundant in warm and humid regions of the world. So aflatoxin producing fungi can contaminate the crops in the field at the harvest and during storage. So aflatoxin's main disadvantage is that it is associated with an increased risk of liver cancer. So milk adulteration has been found, that is National Milk Safety and Quality Survey was undertaken by a third party across all states and UTs recently, released by Food Safety and Standards Authority of India, out of which it has been found that 37% of the total samples tested failed to meet the prescribed quality and 10% of the processed milk samples were non-compliant. So the adulterants like aflatoxin, M1 antibiotics and pesticides such as urea, hydrogen peroxide, detergent were also found in the milk. So aflatoxin M1 is more dominant in processed milk than in raw milk, which is life-threatening usually through damaged liver. So it comes in the milk through feed and fodder that are currently not regulated in the country. So Tamil Nadu, Delhi and Kerala were the top three states where aflatoxin residue was found the most. So India is the world's largest producer of the milk, with the total estimated milk production in the country was 176.35 million tons during 2017-18. So this is about your sixth question. Now let's move to the next question. Next is, Prahari community policing scheme is launched by which state? A. Tamil Nadu, B. Delhi, C. Maharashtra, D. Madhya Pradesh. So friends, it has been launched in New Delhi. So this community policing scheme basically aims to connect the security guards and chowkidars that are local civil personnel to be deployed in commercial and VIP areas. They will act as eyes and ears of the people. So significance, it is launched by Delhi Police, and the aim is to prevent crime and maintain law and order in Delhi. So basically the move will help to bring professionalism in the work of security guards by giving them appropriate training and enabling frequent police prahari interaction and cooperation. Now let's move to the next question. Next is, consider the following pairs. First, Hornbill Festival, Nagaland. Second, Shirui Lili Festival, Manipur. Third, Lozar Festival, Arunachal Pradesh. Fourth, Sagadava Festival, Sikkim. So we have to choose that which of these statements are correct. Let me tell you friends that all of these statements are correct. So Hornbill Festival is celebrated in Nagaland. Shirui Lili Festival is basically celebrated in Manipur. So basically it is celebrated to raise the awareness about Shirui Lili, that is a state flower of Manipur, and it is endangered. So Lozar Festival is then celebrated in Arunachal Pradesh and Sagadeva Festival in Sikkim. So more details are here. So Shirui Lili Festival is an annual 5-day state festival celebrated in Ukhrul district to spread awareness about the endangered state flower Shirui Lili, as well as to promote Ukhrul district as a potential tourist destination in Manipur. Then this Losar is one of the famous festivals in northeast India. So this festival is celebrated in Arunachal Pradesh to welcome the Tibetan New Year. So please note this, such type of questions are asked by UPSC. So Losar Festival is celebrated in Arunachal Pradesh, and is to welcome the Tibetan New Year. So you can be given a statement based question. For example, consider the following statements about Losar Festival. First is, it is celebrated to welcome the Tibetan New Year. Second statement, they may give you that it is celebrated in Arunachal Pradesh. Then you have to choose the correct answer. Then in this case both these statements will be correct. So such type of questions can be asked. So Buddhist tribes, namely Monpa, Shardukhapans, Memba, Khamba, Nauluk, forward for this festival every year and celebrate with all splendor. So Losar is celebrated for a period of 3 years starting from 11 February. So Sagadava is yet another popular festival celebrated in Sikkim during the Tibetan lunar month. So date is flexible according to the position of the moon. So it is a full moon day which decides the day on which the Sagadava is celebrated. So the day holds great significance and has loads of religious belief, as it is known as the month of merit. So then Hornbill Festival is held at Naga Heritage Village Kisama, which is about 12 km from Kohima. So all the tribes of Nagaland take part in this festival. Please note that. So the aim of the festival is to revive and protect the rich culture of the Nagaland and display its extravaganza and traditions. So for visitors, it means a closer understanding of the people and culture of Nagaland and an opportunity to experience the food, songs, dances and customs of Nagaland. So now comes the next question. Next is, consider the following statements related to International Coffee Organization. First, it is a London-based body set up under the auspices of United Nations in 1963 under the International Coffee Agreement of 1962. Second is, the only coffee exporting countries are its members. So we have to choose the correct answer. Let me tell you, friends, that only first statement is correct. That is one statement is correct. So answer would be A. So it is a London-based body set up under the auspices of United Nations in 1963 under the International Coffee Agreement of 1962. So not just coffee exporting countries, but also six importing countries are its members. So answer would be A. That is one only. So this has been formed in 1962 by 1963 under the International Coffee Agreement of 1962. So it was formed to highlight the economic importance that is of there of coffee, and 50 members are there exporting and importing, 44 exporting and importing are 6. And India is also a major exporting country. It is also one among the major exporting countries and European Union in importing country. So it represents 98% of world's coffee production and 67% of world consumption. So it organizes the World Coffee Conference, in which its 5th edition was held in India. So the earlier conferences were held in London, Guatemala, Brazil and Ethiopia. So in its recent report, it highlighted that the next wave of growth of in international coffee industry will come from Asia, and India is expected to play a lead role in driving this growth. Now let's move to the last question of the day. Last question is, River Yamuna originates in the state of A. Uttarakhand, B. Himachal Pradesh, C. Punjab, D. Haryana. So we have to choose that which of these is correct. Let me tell you, friends, that River Yamuna originates from Yamunotri Glacier, that is there in Uttarakhand. So the solution would be A. So originates from Yamunotri Glacier and Uttarakhand. So it is the largest tributary of Ganga. Please note that Yamuna is the largest tributary of Ganga. So it after cutting the deep gorge across Shivalik, it enters into plains near Tajewala and then flows southward up to Agra and then turns southeast to meet Ganga at Allahabad. So famous tributaries of it are Chambal, Sen, Ken and Betwa. So friends, this is all about today's discussion of MCQs. So if you like the MCQs, if you like its quality, the MCQs, the quality of the MCQs, and if you like the video, then do ensure that you like it, share it with your friends, and also ensure that you subscribe to our channel. And lastly, friends, this is our public Telegram channel, the link of which is shown on your screen, and the link of it will also be provided in the description box. So we have more than 14,000 students that are following us on Telegram. So if you want to be one among them, then you are more than welcome to join this public Telegram channel, the link of which you can access in the description box. So also, friends, if you have any doubts, queries, you can mail us at achieveias21@gmail.com, or you can also contact us at 8968920720. And lastly, friends, we also have a website on which you can visit to access various public resources that we have for the purpose of CSE preparation. So this is all about today's video. Thank you, have a very nice day ahead.